The first item is the approval of the minutes of the last meeting. Do we have any comment on them? Look fine. Any motion to approve?
So moved.
Seconded? So moved. The minutes are approved as presented. We have a number of pieces of correspondence that came with us in our packet. They are a policy statement from the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Committee on the green belt signage system, a map of the conservation land in the Stonegate and Dyer Pond subdivisions, a letter from Bill and Marguerite Gatchell, a letter from Kevin and Mary Alice Wallace, a letter from Jerry and Addie Harkavy, a letter from George Higgins, a letter from James Granulati, a letter from W. Phelps Carter, a letter from William Orcutt, a memorandum from Ernest McVeigh, code enforcement officer, and a letter from Ross Cudlitz from the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District. In addition, we have three more pieces of correspondence which are with us tonight, waiting here. We have a memorandum from G. Hunter from the Portland Water District. Thank you for their facts name. We have a memorandum from the Acting Fire Chief Murray relative to Stonegate 4. A letter from Jonesy Service Center, Greg Jones and George Jones. And that is it. Moving along, the first item on the agenda tonight is Stonegate 4. Request by Recall Management for preliminary subdivision approval, a wetlands alteration permit, a permit for construction in a resource protection zone for Stonegate Phases 4, a 17-lot major subdivision located off Stonegate Road, according to Section 16-2-4A7, also a public hearing.
Ms. Chairman, as I have before, I need to recuse myself from consideration of this matter.
All right. In this case, would Judy Lardner, please? In fact, as I see it, you can be appointed for the whole meeting. So why don't you stay aboard here? We have someone from Recall?
Yes, we do. Excuse me.
Indeed.
Can you give me a second to set up, please, and I'll be right with you.
Tim, while you're settling yourself, why don't I appoint you as a voting member as well on this? We're kind of shorthanded. Now we're up to speed. Why don't you introduce yourself and make a brief presentation?
Thank
summary.
You. First of all, are the graphics readable from both the crowd and from the bench?
Speaking for myself, I have a complete light.
Okay, I'll start off. My name, for the record, is Rick Light. I'm an engineer with Land Use Consultants in Portland, representing Recall Management Corporation. With me tonight also is, on my left here, is Dick Michael from Dufresne Henry, who are the original and continuing engineers on the project. We're both here to answer questions after a brief presentation, and feel free to direct your questions, if need be, to myself or to Mr. Michael. Just, I guess, a quick background, and the project's come a long way in the last few months, and in fact, in the last year or so. As it is a public hearing, I'd like to just take a minute to surmise and go over what may be old news to some people, but maybe new to others who haven't been following the project. I think if people remember far enough back, the project was begun in 1989 as a cluster subdivision in a sort of a loop format, which it is not now, and has evolved into a 2,000 foot long cul-de-sac. And the original program began with Stonegate Associates in care of Robert Taylor, and the project was taken over this last fall by Fleet Bank of Maine. And where Recall comes in, as many of you are well aware, As recall is managing the project in behalf of the FDIC through completion. And questions come up when you mention the name recall as to what is going to happen with a project once approved, both at the state and local level. And recall is not in the business at this point of developing projects, to my knowledge. And the intent, of course, of recall to act on behalf of the FDIC is to complete projects as an asset and potentially to sell them off to developers or whatnot. And I believe that is the intent of the project here in terms of recall's role as the shepherd for the project. Basically, what we've done since taking on the project is the new changes in the project since, I guess, last fall and last spring is, I guess, backing up another step, is in May of last year, the planning board was submitted what was previously under Stonegate Associates, the project as it looks now with some minor modifications, which we've made since then. That project being a 17-lot cluster on a 2,000 and slightly over at the time foot cul-de-sac and on the existing parcel. The project now has been cut back to a 2,000-foot length cul-de-sac, as we're all pretty well aware, to conform to the new road standards. And I think that brings us up to where we are now. So I guess on behalf of the board and the members, I'd like to just even go back into just a brief description of the project as it exists and then what we've done since the changes have occurred. And essentially, the project is located off of Stonegate Road, which in turn is located off of Mitchell Road. And we're on the easterly side of Stonegate Road. And the existing parcel is part of the overall complex of the Stonegate subdivision and Dyer Pond subdivision. Essentially, it's the last remaining parcel, being 69 acres, currently of undeveloped land within this overall parcel. And the on this side, which is the south side of the project, is Cranbrook Estates, excuse me. To the north is the, again, Stonegate Phases 1, 2, and 3 along these boundaries here. The Dyer Pond establishment is up to the east. The project is mostly wooded, in fact, almost entirely wooded. And the developed areas, as you see them on the plan here, constitute more or less, without seeing the fine lines of the plan, the upland areas and some of the lands away from the wetlands. Overall, we have about 23 acres of wetlands, leaving about 45, 46 acres of wooded land. I'd like to also mention that this parcel being approximately 69 acres as presented on the plan, in addition to that, there's a parcel of land which was sort of left between the Dyer Pond, Stonegate's Phases 1, 2, and 3 in this subdivision that is also going to be dedicated in fee to the town, and I'll talk about that later when we discuss the open space. Two streams flow through the wetlands in the project, one being Mitchell Brook flowing more or less to the north, and Cranbrook Brook meandering this way and connecting with Mitchell Brook and et cetera, going north towards, eventually towards the Dyer Pond estates up in this area up in here. Most of the green areas here for the proposed conditions are conservation land, but essentially much of that is wetland areas, and the wetlands have been mapped by Normandale Associates of Yarmouth and have been a study has been done over time of the different species and plants and whatnot within the wetlands. Soils on site vary from a most of the highland areas are very typical for the Cape, Lyman Tunbridge type soils. We have some Brayton, Sears Port, and some Sebago mucks. Essentially, in a nutshell, the higher lands are shallow to ledge and very rolling, knobby soil, as is consistent with much of the Cape, and the lowlands are wetland areas, again, some of that being muck-type soils and organic soils. That brings me up to where the project is now and then a little discussion about the project, and I'll try and keep this brief so that we can get on with questions. Again, the design is a cluster design in accordance with the subdivision ordinance for such. The road extends off of the existing Stonegate Road, and what we have done is reconfigure the intersection with the existing Greystone Court. And the road as presented to the board up till now had been called Greystone Road. Greystone Road here had been changed to Greystone Court. In our previous meeting with the board and after discussing road names with the public safety, we have due to phonetically similar names, we've changed the road names to Rock Crest Drive, being the cul-de-sac itself, and leaving Greystone Road as Greystone Road as it is now. The small T cul-de-sac is Quartz Knob Road, and that remains as it is on the plans. I think the plans in front of you don't indicate that because the issue of the road names came up after our submission to the board. But we've indicated that in a memo to the board between, I think, several weeks ago. The road itself is a 24-foot-wide minor street with 120, I believe, foot cul-de-sac with an island in the middle, grassed island. There are no sidewalks, as is consistent with the minor streets and is consistent with the rest of the Stonegate project. The drainage consists of, we have curbing in the roads both sides, a bituminous Cape Cod curb is proposed, and the drainage consists of a catch basin manhole type system, which eventually discharges through several drainage easements into the wetlands and the low points. As far as sewer and utilities, we have a existing sewer within along Mitchell Road and within Stonegate, and the sewer extension will we are going to extend sewer, up to lot one, which is this lot right here. In accordance with the town sewer provisions, we're able to get one lot on sewer. The rest of the 17 or 16 lots, will be on subsurface sewage disposal. And at this point, HHE 200s have been designed in accordance with the state code and have been, to my knowledge, approved at the local plumbing inspector in accordance with local Article 15. So in essence, all the disposal areas have been tested and a suitable area has been found on each lot. We plan on extending water via an 8-inch main up through the cul-de-sac and right now I'm planning a 4-inch main to the Quartz Knob area in here. In terms of water, we have discussed available and required pressures with the fire chief. And at the 11th hour today, I received a note from Portland Water District, which I faxed to the town planner, that indicated that we had, in my discussion with the chief, acceptable pressures at the end of the cul-de-sac to support just a single line. We have 1,200 plus gallons a minute of pressure here available using an 8-inch line, which meets the fire department's requirements for fire protection. Hydrants will be placed at several locations along the road, as in accordance with the chief's comments as well. The project will be serviced by underground telephone, electric, and there was recently a question about street lights, whether or not those are anticipated being provided. At this time, they are not, more or less keeping in accordance with the Stonegate project. some of the major areas on site, some of the major concerns on the site, regarding the layout is where the lots are and how they got to be where they are. Essentially, as I mentioned, the lots 1, 2, 3, etc. around the cul-de-sac and through lot 16 here are all on high lands with the wetlands. I guess they're not too easy to see on this map here. The wetlands have been pretty much, for the most part, dedicated as common open space and to be dedicated to the town. There are some wetland encroachments, such as in here and here, and fingers of wetlands on various lots. But for the most part, there's been a great deal of sensitivity given to keeping lots and better yet, keeping buildings away from wetlands. And in light of the building issue, what we have done is spent quite a deal of time defining building envelopes. Those envelopes being defined by the zoning, minimum zoning setbacks to the front, side, and rear yard, and as well looking at the wetland setbacks and trying to maintain in as many cases as possible a 100-foot setback from the wetlands to a minimum to building sites. And what the plan, and that we couldn't achieve that in all cases due to the irregularity of the wetlands and fingers that snake up into certain lots and that sort of thing, but the rule that we tried to maintain was 100 feet. There are certain lots, such as lot one here, where we have less than 100 feet, lots three, and right here we have 70 feet, etc. I think lot five in here we have maybe 70, 80 feet, but we've tried to maintain 100 feet wherever possible. And based on the geography out there, we've had to modify that somewhat. But the emphasis has been on protecting the wetlands. And the a major point of discussion between some of the abutters' comments that I've received and between earlier discussions with the board is what we're allowing to happen on the lots. And the lots themselves, basically shown in these areas here, are what we are referring to as the building envelopes. These are shown more or less as a cleared area, just for graphical presentation. The intent is not that those would be cleared areas, but that those would be available areas for placement of homes, driveways, septics, etc. On the lots, we've proposed that the deed and covenants which go with the stone gates 1, 2, and 3 be continued with this subdivision here. There will be a homeowners association established, or I should say the existing home, our proposal is to amend the existing homeowners association and continue on with the same language that exists in that for stone gates 1, 2, and 3, which essentially describes in detail lot and deed covenants restricting the amount of clear cutting on lots so that essentially there can be no clear cutting on lots. The restrictions on what can be done and what can't be done within the established buffers, such as saving of trees and restricting trees only, cutting of trees only to those that are diseased and whatnot. And we feel that this is both a strong point of the subdivision, and in light of the stone gate one, phases 1, 2, and 3, it basically, I think the premises of this whole subdivision has been that it will fall in place with the first three phases, and I think that by establishing the homeowners association and continuing on with that theme, we'll achieve that end. There are several areas of wetland fill, of very minor areas. One is at the entrance right here where the T intersection is going to be. One is at this area here in the road. The total wetland fill, is 6,350 square feet, whereas the previous subdivision presented back in 1989 with a loop road was over 2.5 times that amount. So this design has really crunched down the amount of wetland that is impacted. Open space, I mentioned that we are proposing this vast amount of open space, which totals 31 acres on the site, and 11 acres for a total of 42 acres with the Stonegate 4 subdivision in this remaining parcel out here. This land would be dedicated to the town, consistent with the land on the previous Stonegate subdivision. Restrictions on the land would be placed to keep it in for conservation purposes only. And the deed language and the covenants on that land, we intend to follow the same language in terms of covenants that was provided for the Stone Gates phases 1, 2, 3. An issue that we've discussed both with the planning board, with the abutters, and with the abutters through the Conservation Commission, and with the Conservation Commission themselves, and have made site walks with the Conservation Commission and the town planner to discuss our trails. We have a parcel of land here that extends up to Dyer Pond that is currently proposed as a 50-foot right-of-way not to be developed at this point. The purpose of that trail was at the request of the planning board. My understanding is that this was meant to be a potential future access, but there is no intent at this point at all to put a road or connecting road through here. In fact, just the opposite is true. We would hope that a connecting road would never go in there. A trail will connect through to the Dyer Pond Greenbelt plan and connects all the way through Fort Williams. A second trail, at this point an easement, will be provided between lots 2 and 1, which accesses the existing, it's a paper street, Allen Road, which connects with Mitchell Road in this area here. And we've also proposed that's dependent upon the outcome of the Conservation Commission's thoughts on this, is potential for a trail connection to the open space here and across an easement on lot 3 and through lot 2 to connect back in through here. The trail, there are some logistics that we are trying to discuss and work out with the Conservation Commission and with our abutters on this issue, but we are open to the intent of providing a trail connection through here to the back of lot 2 and potentially across an abutting lot here if access can be gained by the commission. The drainage on the site is controlled in a nutshell, again, as I mentioned, by catch basins, manholes, and whatnot, but the overall site watershed has been analyzed, including the upstream areas up and through here, and that is controlled by several weirs, which are structures placed in the existing streams. those weirs are located, and here's our project, Mitchell Road, Stonegate. Those weirs are located within the common open space of Stonegate 1, 2, and 3. And the drainage concept for all of this subdivision meaning Stonegate, the entire Stonegate and Dyer Pond, accounts for the increased runoff, and DEP at this point has signed off on the drainage calculations, and so I believe the town engineer has no concerns at this point with the drainage in terms of off-site impacts. In fact, there is a net decrease for this 25-year storm from the development of the site due to the placement of those weirs. And I should mention those weirs, as many members of the board are aware, are already in place and are functioning. In a nutshell, that's a description of the property. I hope I didn't go into too much detail, but I think it's necessary to at least update those members of in the audience who haven't been following the project. At this point, I'd be happy to open up to the discussion with the abutters and with the board.
Okay, at this point, I think we'll open it to the public hearing. And as I've heard many times at public hearings, I'll give you the rules, and I'm going to give you what I've always wanted. Number one, would you please come to the podium and announce who you are and where you live? Keep your comments as succinct as possible. They have always asked if you have the same thing to say never to come up, but I'd like you to put your hands up so I have some idea how many people may be on the same wavelength but aren't coming to the podium. That's just for me. I'll probably get my hand smacked, but that's the way I'll do it. Who would like to speak?
Good evening. My name is Jim Granulati. I live at 56 Stonegate Road, Cape Elizabeth, which is lot number 10 in the phase one of Stonegate development. I'm currently the president of Stonegate Homeowners Association, and I have been such since the beginning of January. Two of the responsibilities of the association are to review house plans to assure that they conform with the declaration and the covenants of the neighborhood, and also they maintain the entrances to the neighborhood. The monies to pay for the common area maintenance is raised through an annual dues payment, and all the lot owners in phase 1, 2, and 3 are part of this association. The board of directors within the last two and a half weeks became aware of Recall Management's interest in reviving the subdivision plan and making revisions to it. As a result of that, the association has been unable to take an official stand on the site plan that's before you because of timing requirements to call special meetings. Therefore, the comments that I'm about to make are personal comments. One of the things I heard tonight, which several comments have come to my attention through individuals that live in the association in the neighborhood, and some of these individuals may speak tonight. I know you've gotten some of the letters. I know I personally wrote a letter to the planning board. And one of the things I was pleased to hear tonight, although there has been no contact to the best of my knowledge, and that is that the applicant plans on incorporating the new phase into the existing Stonegate Homeowners Association. That probably has been the biggest source of concern as to whether or not the existing integrity of the neighborhood would continue in this phase, particularly because we share common entrances onto Mitchell Road and drives of that sort. So I would hope that the covenants and the bylaws that are currently existing for Stonegate Associates are a requirement of the new subdivision. Thank you.
You're welcome. Who else? Thank you.
My name's Rick Knowlton. I'm the owner of lot number 4 here in the corner of Stonegate Road and whatever it's called now, it was Greystone. We also live in Cape Elizabeth now. My family and I live at 15 Campion Road. We haven't built on our lot yet in Stonegate, and one of the reasons we haven't was our concern over this phase. I was aware from Bob Taylor when we purchased the lot that phase four was inevitable and in the works. So I'm not ignorant of the process that it's been through. I too was pleased to hear Rick Light say tonight that the covenants and restrictions would be part of the project. But I also have another concern in hopes to protect my future investment. And that is an issue that Mr. Parker has brought up at the last meeting, which is the continuation of this right-of-way through to Dyer Pond and Shore Road. And I know that it's probably good planning to allow a 50-foot wide easement right-of-way for some future road. And I hope some of you have walked that site and that proposed right-of-way, along with all the other trails that are through there. It's quite nice, but it is a thing that I believe would detract seriously from our neighborhood in the future. And I would strongly like to urge the board to reconsider perhaps not the provision for a trail, but the provision for a future road through the 50-foot right-of-way width. And would suggest, from my opinion, biased as it may be, that a 20 or 25-foot pedestrian easement consistent with the rest of the plan might be more appropriate for that connector. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Knowlton.
Good evening. My name is Piotr Stamieszkin. I live on 5 Granite Ridge Road. And I have a few comments. The first one deals with the wetlands. A few years ago, we passed an ordinance which was very restrictive and progressive. Here, I still see some variances, and it's not clear to me, you know, what kind of hardships are involved in actually observing the ordinance as it is. Also, my concern is heightened by the fact that we're not really asking for sewer in this new phase. I think that I heard many times comments that we should expand our base of sewer users as opposed to people on lots with septic systems. And this is a perfect opportunity to do that. Also, I think combination of wetlands and septic systems, a dangerous combination. I think longer term, it's perhaps a recipe for problems, environmental problems. And now we're replacing a lot of septic systems in other parts of the Cape. In 20 years, we'll be doing the same here. So I don't feel comfortable really with putting septic systems so close to wetlands and then also giving variances to the developer. In terms of the path, the trails, I consider the trails an asset to Cape Elizabeth and to the development in a sense. However, I think that the value of a trail system comes also from the fact that they are continuous, that actually they connect. It's an interconnected system. Here I see separate parts of a trail that don't connect, or trail that really runs over the roads. I mean, that way, I mean, in terms of having a green belt, not connected, but rather using the roads, I mean, we have it already now. I mean, you can go from one place to another. What I would suggest is to get easements that will actually create an interconnected network of trails. And I think it's a perfect opportunity to achieve these easements now when there's an application for this phase. And I think it's doable here. Also, in terms of the trails, I would say that it's very important that they are marked appropriately, that there is signage, that the access is marked. Currently, many times people go through their lots because they don't know how to get out or how to get in. And they sometimes go across my lot. I think that it's important that the trails are just maintained. Also, there's a lot of erosion because the trails are not maintained and people on a variety of bikes basically destroy the trail system. So if we are serious about having a trail system, then I think the Cape has to invest. It has to be appropriate signage, restrictions being be known to everybody, and the Cape has to reinforce it, whatever the rules there are. Okay. In terms of the road, this proposed connector, I also would like to suggest that the board reconsiders it. I think that it would create potential hazard, especially for children. I mean, it would basically create a very fast artery from Shore Road to Mitchell Road. And to a degree that this is not, it's not clear that it's necessary, I would suggest not to have it simply, as opposed to create this potential for another hearing in a few years when we really have a major issue on hand. I was a little bit surprised by lot number 17. It seems to be a little bit kind of strange place, just general comment. And besides that, I was encouraged on the other hand by statements about conservation land and the fact that the new phase would come under the bylaws of Stonegate 1, 2, and 3, and some of its restrictive covenants, and I hope that it goes beyond an intention, and actually the association is approached and there is some kind of formal process set, perhaps making a condition of this approval, or I don't know what kind of jurisdiction the board has, but I think it's important that it goes beyond intentions. And this sums up my comments. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Petrovsky?
Excuse me?
I was just trying to repeat your name. Petrovsky?
No, I can spell it for you.
Would you please, over our minutes?
Okay, my first name is P-I-O-T-R, and my last name is S-T-A-M-I-E-S-Z-K-I-N. Thank you.
I'm sorry.
Okay, 5 Granite Ridge Road.
That's okay. Fine. Yes, I got that. I got that.
Good evening. My name is George Higgins, 22 Stonegate. I was also encouraged to hear that that the bylaws of the association that allowed and made us join, not made us, but was the reason that we joined the association are going to hopefully be intact, because I think there are some good sensitive measures there, including the tree issue that you talked about and so forth. So I'm pleased about that. I'm also pleased with your hopes that that never becomes a major artery toward the Dyer Pond project. I do have several concerns I would like to share with you. There is a lot of motorized off-road vehicles in that area now, dirt bikes, snowmobiles, etc. And I agree that as we develop the trail system, this has to be addressed, because I do think it becomes a conduit for that kind of activity, which I do not believe, as a person who lives there and walks there with our dogs, is appropriate. I also am concerned about Lot 17. It just doesn't seem to fit. I walk there frequently with our dogs. It's a very, very precipitous drop right into wetland. The access would also have to come out onto Stonegate Road, and I think that brings up issues of, again, sewer, electricity, etc. I would like others who are smarter than I on this issue to address Lot 17, but it really does seem to stick out as an add-on or an afterthought. It also seems to me that it will perhaps reconfigure these other two lots to make them perhaps less or more tightly buildable toward the road than they otherwise would be. So my concerns would be hoping that we don't have another major access here through Dyer Pond, because I really do not see the need for that. My concern is also how do we control traffic, motorized traffic, in our trail systems that we develop them. And my last concern again is Lot 17. I hope somebody else has some comments about 17 before the evening's over. Thank you.
Thank you. Please.
I'm Addie Harkavy. My husband is Jerry, and we own Lot 48, which is to be 23 Stonegate Road. When we purchased 23 Stonegate Road, or Lot 48, when we signed the contract, we came to the planning board, and things were in disarray because a new planner had just taken over and asked if there were any plans for the area behind our lot, and nobody was able to find any at the time. And the realtor didn't tell us, and the seller didn't tell us, and We have the feeling now that there was prior knowledge of this because we put the property under contract in February 1991 and closed in April 1991. Yes, lot 48, I can see it's right here. It's listed as Thielen. And it directly abuts lot 17, as does lot 47. And we're also gratified to hear that the covenants of the subdivision are proposed to be upheld in the newer area. But we have some very serious concerns. Our major concerns, obviously, are what might be directly behind us and have some impact not only on our property values but upon the environment. In terms of the whole of Phase 4, we are concerned about the impact of septic systems on wetlands. We're not prepared. We don't really know enough to know what that impact might be. But we certainly have serious concerns. And we share the concerns of others who feel that Cape Elizabeth has been increasingly trying to get homes onto the sewer system, and here's a subdivision going in with septic. Specifically, though, to address Lot 17, the right-of-way that would go into it is apparently narrower than the right-of-way that goes into other, or the access to other, so-called pork chop lots. And the other so-called pork chop lots in Stonegate differ from Lot 17 in that from each of those pork chop lots, the front of the home or one side of the home has a direct view of Stonegate Road. In the case of Lot 17, there's no direct view of the road, and in fact the direct view would be to the back of our lot and the back of Dr. Wallace's lot, which is Lot 47. And in order to get to the road, you would more or less have to make a right angle turn and come out right in front of another home's driveway. And this is really in direct contrast to the way the rest of phases 1, 2, and 3 have been laid out. So we feel that it's not in keeping at all with the rest of the subdivision. The other concern we have is, even with adequate marking, why should a pedestrian walk up a 30-foot embankment when they can walk down a nice driveway to get to the pedestrian right-of-way? And there also appears to be a reasonable supposition that would-be pedestrians may park in that driveway and block it. Well, cars parked in that driveway, which would come out onto Stonegate Road, would be, aside from anything else, unsightly. And it really wouldn't maintain the character of a residential neighborhood. We're also concerned by the fact that the driveway, as currently proposed, would run directly parallel to the pedestrian right-of-way and would be well above the house. We're also concerned, and we don't really know, or we're not authorities on septic drainage, but we understand that an elaborate septic system has been proposed for Lot 17, that it's above the house, and since the area is very wet, here we have something like a 30-chamber septic system with a somewhat elaborate design on land that is above the house. So between the septic system and this driveway, where there's some potential for ice hazard, if nothing else, we're quite concerned about the impact on the integrity of the Stonegate neighborhood as it currently exists and upon the two lots that directly abut it. I think that pretty much summarizes my husband's and my comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hockerby. We have someone else speaking?
My name is William Gatchell. I live at 10 Belfield Road in Cranbrook. My wife and I submitted to you a letter, and basically I would like to review that letter with an idea of re-emphasizing some of the concerns that were brought up in it and the attached letters for the previous reviews of Stonegate 4 that were started by Mr. Taylor, and I'm not sure if they have been made a record prior to this as part of the subdivision. And I'd also like to ask for a minute if you could clarify the walkway easement or whatever along lot number 2.
Yeah.
I couldn't quite see it from where I was sitting, and I thought it might be.
And this is lot three, right in through here.
Mm-hmm.
And here's your property right here. Your house sits right about right here.
Yep.
And what we proposed is undefined trail at this point through the open space, through a 25-foot easement back to your lot. We met out on the site. Myself, the town planner and conservation commission chairperson, met out on the site to determine the best potential point if a trail, say if were to come through here, mm-hmm. to go. This, as it's shown now, runs up over that ledge cliff.
Right.
I've marked that out in the field, if you'll look at that out there, roughly.
We've been out, yep.
And find that the best way is probably to continue about 50 feet over where the existing mm-hmm. trail is, and would modify our final plan if this trail system is approved, and if we can all come to some agreement on the need or desire for an easement here, we would angle that where the trail goes and connect it back up along the inside lot line here. I would propose a 15-foot wide easement at this point to, I believe, if this is not your, is this your property here?
No, our property ends right about where that line monument is.
That's what we had thought, and that it would end at that line there. And to continue the easement across here, I would propose that the Conservation Commission, I propose that the Commission approach this homeowner here and try and get an easement across their land. One, because it's a nice spot. Number two is because to put an easement all the way across lot two tightens the building window. In other words, it restricts this person's privacy, I believe. And we have offered a lot. You know, this is several hundred feet on this lot.
Mm-hmm. I couldn't really speak for this landowner, except that when you get down to this side right here, you're in standing water.
Right. We understand that. We've walked that with the commission. They mm-hmm. understand that to put an easement to there, they would have to create a hopping stone sort of a trail. It's iced in winter, so it's skiable, walkable mm-hmm. in the summertime, to put a few stones or to create a way to get across there. And that would be up to the commission if they can secure an easement across this.
And then blend into Allen Avenue or something.
Yeah. If I could just take a second, while we're on the issue of the easements, we had proposed an easement across the back of this lot right here behind mm-hmm. your house.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I made it clear in the last meeting, and if not, I'd like to restate that with the trail easements, we're trying to provide an asset to the association, to the people of the town, to you, to continue using trails which are an existing resource. And we're trying to make every effort to work with the requirements of the board in terms of lots, restrictions, and whatnot, and with the abutters to come to some sort of conclusion as to what's best. I'm flexible. Whatever it works out best in terms of the commission's needs, in terms of the overall green space plan, looking at the town as a whole and not getting boondoggled down by particular problems, which mm-hmm. may be appropriate now, but they also may prevent roadblocks from the future access of a major trail system. I think that we need to put our heads together with the Conservation Commission, but we're flexible on a lot of these issues here at this point.
Okay, well, I, in general, I think that in my letter, our letter reflects that a good deal of planning and thought needs to go into it. We'd like to be in a position to offer an easement across our land, but because of the site location of our home and the amount of land there, it's certainly not very practical, number one. Number two, any trail across our land would end up on Belfield Road, I assume, and that's a private road. It's maintained privately by the Belfield Association, all the ramifications that go along with that, and therefore we as a resident down there are not in a position to grant anybody a right to go to that road. And I will allude to the fact that when the subdivision was first put in there and before many of the homes were built, Belfield Road, and also before it was paved, Belfield Road was a parking lot at certain times of the year because people came down to hop on the ski trails or whatever, and they had no concern at that time for obstructing other people's passage, if you will, and there probably wasn't a big problem except for those existing homes that were way down in Belfield Road. But as time went on, we had to ask people not to park down there because eventually you just couldn't get through. And if you have a trail and it ends up on that road, it would be a big problem. So we're just, unfortunately, we're not in a position to help you out. And as far as any kind of a trail along Lot 3, we're right on, we utilize a setback requirement because of trying to fit into the hill in our construction, and we know that we're close to that boundary of Lot 3, and if you were to put an easement across Lot 3, two things, it would be right next to our home within 30 feet of our living room, which I don't think we'd really cherish the thought of people that close to us, and secondly, it once again, you'd be at a dead end, and I don't think that's a good situation to be with. We would object to that.
Excuse me, can you show me where your house is on your lot?
Our house is right in this corner right here. It's the side of the house is about 30 feet back from this property line right here, located right there. The trail or easement that was discussed would probably come through the swale here, and once again, it's right in our backyard. And from the issue of personal privacy, we're just really not interested. I don't want to spend too much time repeating what is here, but what I would like to do is, in the paragraph A of that letter, we referenced several letters that were sent to the Planning Board, the Department of Environmental Protection, to Mr. Robert Taylor of Stonegate, and also a letter from the Belfield Association that was, at that time, the president of the association wrote a letter. And one of the main concerns of that letter was the drainage from Cranbrook, which ends up going down, eventually down this way, which I believe the gentleman from land use referred to. And the use of this roadway for the connection into Dyer Pond would go across that drainage area. And I think that a great deal of consideration should be given, if even if it's ended up a paper street, that necessary language be included to be sure that when a road goes in there, that the drainage concern is addressed at that time. I'm sure that it would be, but reaffirming it in verbiage is always a safer bet. We did notice that the setback or building envelope in Lot 3 had been moved back 100 feet from our property line, and we certainly appreciate that. It would not only lend us more privacy, but also whoever were to build in Lot 3. And further, looking at Lot 3, the access to it, putting a roadway in there might be a challenge, and it leaves some doubt in my mind, and I think some of the other landowners down that way, as to exactly how Lot 3 is going to work and not challenge the wetlands. But once again, I think that's one of the issues that needs to be addressed by the Planning Board. I did refer earlier to the easements here, and we cannot concur with the idea of putting any dead-ended walkway up to our land, pedestrian easement used or not used. I think it's asking for problems down the road. Somebody later on with a different idea may feel that they have the right to walk across that, and when they come to our property line, just decide to keep going, and I think it challenges liability of people coming across our land who are not invited. I also mentioned that in my letter, our letter, that the early contact with abutting landowners is crucial to establishing the information and so forth, and what the abutting landowners' interests are, and protecting them as you go through the plans of developing the easements. We also talked about topography, and I think that in the last few days some action was taken to review the area and maybe make some changes in that regard, so that the pedestrian easement, if it works in a loop or whatever, can actually somehow make it the way it was it originally laid on there. It was quite a challenge. The planning of a pedestrian walkway should be, in our opinion, predicated on maintaining personal privacy of the landowner, and of course, with further discussion this evening, trying to move away from lot number two a little bit, I think is headed in that direction, but personally, I think it's still too tight. The person that would build a home in lot number two, I think, is not going to really cherish the idea of a pedestrian walkway being quite so close. We've walked over that way and looked out of curiosity, and I think it bears a lot more thought. I also think that any pedestrian walkway, the ideas, concept, and whatever, needs to be predicated on the ability to police the area relative to motorized traffic and other non-passive use. Now, the Conservation Commission's guidelines, which you have, I think are the same ones that were mailed to us, and it says non-passive use. When we moved into Cranbrook, Cranbrook has a covenant and it prohibits motorized vehicles, etc., but we had people doing figure eights in the field in front of our house, which we own, on skidoos in the middle of the winter. Then they used the ATVs in the summer, and it was a little bit of a challenge to knock that back. It was done. Fortunately, it didn't take long, and it wasn't too difficult, but it was the fact that people had to be approached. So I think that some thought should be given to that aspect of it. Also, in the standards for the Greenbelt walkway policy, it was mentioned that that information signs would be posted in places such as Fort Williams and so forth at the ends or at the heads of these walkways and trails. And without sounding snobbish or too much of an isolationist or protecting my privacy or somebody else's or anybody else's in the town of Cape Elizabeth, the town many years ago purchased Fort Williams, and in later years, after the town had done its thing and made a rather nice park, it was noted that out-of-town people, out-of-state people, were utilizing Fort Williams and benefiting from what we as a town had done. And it's nice to do that, but it got to a point where there was discussion, and it may still be ongoing, as to whether to charge a fee for out-of-town people to use Fort Williams Park. It is a town park. And I guess what we're talking about is town pedestrian walkways or non-passive use walkways. And I personally think that if you put a large sign out that has all the trails marked that you're once again opening the back door, if you will, to the general public, as in outside of the town of Cape Elizabeth. And I think a more appropriate approach would be that for those people that are taxpayers in the town or own land and therefore would be a taxpayer or rent an apartment in the town, should be given a map of the trails as they're developed so that the people in the town can have the benefit of that and enjoy it and somehow keep it from becoming of national interest. Some of the things that do happen, even if you don't have a pedestrian easement through your land, are one corner property marker on Belfield Road between my lot and the one adjacent to it, sometime in September, disappeared. I'm not just sure who it was, and I don't want to cast blame, but at that moment in time, it were folks that were running through on mountain bikes. And they were coming out of the woods, going across the field, and probably somebody saw it and didn't like it or thought it was a hazard, so they picked it out. Well, now I've got to go to land use consultants and probably pay them to relocate the corner so that I can keep out of mischief with my landowner next, adjacent landowner next to us. Those are small things, but they do add up, and some of these things should be considered when it comes time to establishing the trails across the land. Again, we're somewhat apologetic that we can't accommodate the idea of an easement going across our land, but we certainly encourage the Conservation Commission to pursue it, and that concludes my comments. Thank you very much.
Do we have any other speakers?
I'm Bill Arcott, and I live at 20 Stonegate Road, which is across from the lot 49 that's owned by Fleet Bank. And the people have my letter, and I'll be a lot briefer than what my letter was. First off, I'd like to know where the interest is. The old applicant, when he was developing phase four, on several occasions sent myself and my wife a letter with a map that explains different changes and different things he was doing with phase four. And at the end of each letter, he would have a phone number. We could call him, say, hey, gee, sounds like a good idea, keep it up, whatever. The thing that I'm trying to drive at least he seemed to have an interest to say that we're concerned about your needs. Right now, there's two homeowners on Stonegate Road that, let's say, abut this property. There's another one that's three-fourths completed, and another one that's ground was just broken recently. It stands for lots 20, 21, 22, and 24. All of us were affected by phase four, but not one of these families got a notice of this public hearing. And I think it's a damn shame. At least if you go through Mr. Taylor's notes, which are downstairs, he had a whole checkoff list of who he notified, each time he notified them and when. It showed that he had a lot of interest going along with the guidelines of the town ordinance and notifying all the abutters that were within 750 feet. I don't know how many people got notice. Some people apologized tonight. They didn't know about this until just recently. In fact, most people that did get letters, they got them on the 12th or the 13th of this month. So if they're going to write a letter, they're too late. You guys want to have it in your folder 10 days before. I think something should be addressed if there's ever again another public hearing, which I doubt. The other thing I've got to mention is on lot 17, mentioning as a pork shop lot, I don't see where it's consistent with the rest of Stonegate. That lot is smaller. It wants a 25-foot driveway versus a 45 or a 50. Its building envelope is a lot smaller. If you look at the ones that he had compared to in his notation from the last meeting, they're double in size. Plus the other thing, a developer had developed those lots, sited each home to make them appealing and keep them consistent with the development. We're not going to get that with the new Phase 4 unless you people have a controlling handle and make the right decisions. The other thing is with Lot 3, it wasn't mentioned too much tonight, I just don't see how they're really going to get there. They're going to try to put a driveway in, but I'm certainly no soils expert or a developer. But my concerns are it seems to be thrown in like Lot 17, just to try to make a nice, neat package and sell the property. That's all I have to say tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Orcutt.
I'm Kevin Wallace, and my wife and I currently own Lot 47, which abuts Lot Number 17. I can say that I'm pleased to hear that the developer proposes that the homeowners' covenants and restrictions apply to Phase 4, and that the pedestrian easement toward the Dyer Pond development be preserved as such. I'd like to voice my and our concerns which I share with others who have already spoken before me about lot number 17. That I can do by referring to my letter, and I'll just briefly summarize the points I made in that. First of all, it really does deviate from what my and my wife's expectations were for the future development of this neighborhood. I feel that lot number 17 is really very much out of character with the rest of the neighborhood. Secondly, the proposed access to the building portion of the lot potentially creates a number of hazards. The potential increase in off-road motor vehicle traffic on that pedestrian walkway really concerns me, and the attendant hazards to residents and other users of that pedestrian walkway, as well as to the local environment and the impact on the local environment. I'm also concerned that it may create a winter ice hazard, and that may present a risk to both pedestrian and vehicular users of that area, probably mainly residents. I do share a concern about the adequacy of the septic system, which I hear proposed. I'm not going to pretend to be any more of an expert than anybody else who has spoken on behalf of the neighborhood. I'm concerned about the potential for its adverse impact on the wetland areas. And I guess there certainly is a question in my mind of how the proposed development can be reconciled with what certainly has been set forth as more progressive zoning ordinances, really designed to protect the environment. That's all.
Thank you, Dr. Wallace. Do we have any more speakers?
Bob Higgins again. The only other issue I failed to mention was the access that we now maintain through our dues, the entranceway to Stonegate. That would be the entranceway to the new project, and It seems to me that that marries the projects very much into the Stonegate Association, so I just wanted to make that point. We do maintain those, and we had hoped to improve that particular entrance to be similar to the other entrance, and I assume that would be part of this plan.
Thank you very much. Mr. Roberts from the Conservation Commission.
Thank you, Judy. My name is Jack Roberts, and I'm the chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission. I would just like to make a few comments, I guess, on the trail system and what we've done. Alluding to what Mr. Gatchel had indicated, we do want to come up this way and out and through Allen Road. If we cannot get the parcel off on Route Lot 2, nothing will be marked. We are merely looking towards the future and would hope at some point we could get that. The trail, as we saw it the other day when we went out, if we could get on the other side of the rock wall and down over a knoll, would provide adequate privacy for that lot. Further, there is an extreme wetland area on this side, as was mentioned, which is between where the trail would go and the house that's out on Mitchell Road. They'd be afforded all the privacy that they needed. And if we can't get that kind of an easement now, maybe 50 years from now the town can. The Conservation Commission and the town have picked up a number of parcels of land that are not marked. They will not be marked because they are dead-ended. But at some point, we hope to connect this system all together. And that's why we look for these things now when the development is going in. It's nearly impossible to go back later and pick up something if you don't get it now when the development's being made. The markers that we want to put in, a map that's given out just individuals is not going to work. We can't stamp them confidential. But the markers are just going to be a 4 by 5 inch green metal piece of it's probably steel, stainless steel of some type, that will be going on to a 4 inch bollard rough hewn, and we're not planning on placing them right on the street, but it would be back far enough primarily to keep people on the trail and not on private property. The informational sign that was mentioned for Fort Williams, that was a conceptual idea way down the road. We don't have the money to do it, and I'm not sure. So if the people have a real concern with that, we're certainly receptive to ideas on how we could do that. As far as the trail behind Mr. Gatchel's property going towards his house, based on our walk the other day, and the commission hasn't met on this is my own feeling, there is an area down below here with it through the town-owned land, what we will own, where if at some point we could get access to the lower portion of Cranbrook, we could pick it up down there. So we probably don't need this one anyway. Our intent in going that way was to provide access to the Cranbrook residents into Stonegate and not to try to force something onto them. But my guess is from this point, we don't need that particular access anyway. There's something available down below. But I've got to talk with the rest of the members on that one.
I thought you ran it.
Sometimes I try to. But I don't think the trail system is going to be used. It'll be used primarily by neighbors, and we hope to have these trails all around town, not just in Stonegate. We have 14 parcels of land that we currently own. Each development that's going into town from now on, we'll be doing similar things. And we're not looking, and the trails become part of the town property and are overseen by the police. And if we say no motorized vehicles, obviously we can't be out there all the time, but right now when they're not even in the town's hands, they're getting those. So hopefully if we mark them that they're not to be there, maybe we'll have a little more authority than we have now.
Can you show us exactly where you would like to see
the trail? The trail, as Rick mentioned, comes up, there's two of them. One comes up and goes into the road and then out Allen Road, but there is, obviously it's not a green belt when you're going down a street. We want to come along behind the, come down this way and come behind the properties and swing around the corner and out through Allen Road, down through this way, or I'm not even sure where I am on this map. Maybe behind this one and down around this way.
What about the other side of the property?
Over on here? Yeah. There's trails that will be going through town property down here, existing trails that hook up over behind Loxley Road. They come up through the Dyer Pond subdivision. There are obviously existing trails here that the town loses, but and this one will be a new one. try to make up for some of these that we are losing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Put it up now. Have the trails, the locus of all the trails there.
Yeah.
Make better sense. I'm going to hold that up.
Is that going to work? Yeah, good. Okay, we're down here on Shore Road this way. Mitchell Road is up here. This particular one, as indicated, I don't think we need it. There's another area down through here that we can, down below, that we can get out this way at some point if it's ever available to us. We'd like this from this one over this way to get out to, on to Mitchell Road without having to go down a road. If we don't get it, it won't be marked. If we don't get this particular piece in here, this won't be marked. It'll just be something to keep in the future for future use. And if we have an opportunity to go that way.
And the trail in the northern part would be lost?
The trail, none of these trails you see would be lost. These are all existing. Any trails up and through here, these would be lost. But that's part of the development. I haven't seen all of the trails in through there. At some point I hope to be able to, but I'm sure most of these neighbors have walked most of them at one time or another. Okay. Any other questions or comments I might add?
No, I'm very happy for your explanation of a number of points that came up in the public hearing. While you're, do we have anyone else that wishes to speak at the public hearing? In which case, I will call the public hearing is closed. And I personally want to thank all of you who came. As a planning board member, I get an enormous amount from hearing what you have to say. And I know that Jack Roberts will also agree that sometimes you feel as though you're working in a vacuum and you have no idea what people want or think, and you try to make the right decision. But these are wonderful. I'm sure he got a lot out of tonight, too. Mr. Light.
I know you just closed the public hearing. Can I take a chance to respond to some of those comments?
Oh, of course.
Is that too late?
I haven't any idea. I'll reopen it. It's open. You come up, and then I'll close it again. I'm sorry.
I believe typically that is done after a public hearing anyway.
That's what I thought, but I wasn't. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, I'd say I appreciate the comments from the abutters, and I just received a package from the numerous abutters, most of you that spoke on Friday afternoon and spent this morning taking a look at it. I was actually impressed by the amount of concern by the abutters for a project of this type, and most of you are all from the same neighborhood. I guess the two or three areas I'd just like to comment on that our philosophy and what we plan on doing, and one is the emphasis on Lot 17. First of all, what we plan on doing actually, the design now is that this, the extension of the, you call it the pork chop portion of it, the access portion of it, would be onto Stonegate Road, would require taking a 25-foot right-of-way from Lot 49 and amending the recording plat for Lot 49. Whereas Lot 49 is going to be, this will be taken out of 49. The easement, the pedestrian easement runs parallel to the driveway. We've walked Lot 17 and taken a look at it, and I certainly appreciate the comments that, in fact, this is the cluster portion of the subdivision. This is not. And as I mentioned at the last meeting, I took a look at Stonegate Phases 1, 2, and 3, and there is a situation on the top of the shoehorn, I call it, up here on the top of the loop, and the numbers of the lots escape me. I believe it's 35 and 36, or 36 and 37. I'm not sure of the lot numbers. A situation when you have two houses, one in front of the other, and a few minutes ago one gentleman up here mentioned the lack of control they would have over the design of this lot. I want to remind people that what goes on with this lot is in every way covered by the deeds, or would be covered by the deeds, restrictions, and covenants that goes on with the rest of these lots, i.e. the siting of that house in accordance with the current documents, as I understand them from Stonegate Associates, which we will adopt, requires essentially a site plan review, for lack of a better term, architectural code and site plan review. So the siting of this house can't be a complacent siting. It has to be environmentally sound and has to be looked at by a site plan review through the association. And and granted, this, I can't stand here and tell the abutters that you won't be able to see a house from each of these lots, lots 49 and 48 or 47. However, I believe, conversely, abutters to any of the two lots in the subdivision can see each other. Okay, so what we offer there is a lot that has a potential for it. It has a potential for a very interesting lot. We looked at it in our minds have sited a place where we know we would like to site a house and how it could work with a walkout basement, etc., and could work well with the topography on the lot. A difficult lot, a tough lot, yes, but then again, sometimes those make the most interesting lots. And I think if you walk around and look at Stonegate phases 1, 2, and 3, you'll find that across the board from a planning perspective, many of those lots are or were very difficult lots, and they've become very well landscaped and well thought out lots. The other issue in terms of, I guess we've been over the trails enough. I guess there was a comment earlier on about the environmental review of the subdivision. I just want to, just for the record, state where the project stands. I mentioned earlier that we have been through DEP. And in DEP's review, the issue of subsurface leachate from septic systems, we have to pass muster with DEP. We have to pass muster with the state Department of Health Engineering to get the septic systems approved and sited on each lot. And two things to remind people of is that these are very large lots, in consideration that much of the town is 20,000 square foot zoning, and septic may be allowed on those lots. These lots are twice, three times that size. In our, what we prefer, of course, is to have septic, or sewer, excuse me. If we could have sewer and sewer the project, I think that is preferred. But the local ordinances and local political situation regarding sewer does not allow us to do that. So that the septic has been designed to meet the environmental standards which the state DEP and the state health engineering have reviewed, have accepted, and will sign off on in terms of our DEP permit. I also appreciate some of the concerns from the abutters, and we have the same concerns, just to reiterate, of the privacy of lot homeowners. There's been a lot of talk about trails, and I, for one, can only, the most important thing to me in looking for a house is trails. I spend most of my free time on trails and in the woods. That is where I'd like to be. I also sense at the same time that people would love to use the trails that are there. It's not their land. They would like to continue to use the trails, and we're trying to make amends the best way we can to work with the Conservation Commission and the abutters to make a system work here. Again, we are remaining flexible, but I think in terms of privacy, and the subdivision doesn't work if there isn't a certain amount of privacy. People here respect their privacy. They have it now, and we're trying to maintain privacy on some of the more difficult lots here by offering what we can, but at the same time saying, for instance, no, that we can't put we don't feel it's appropriate to put a pedestrian easement along here. We'd love to connect it through. It just, I think, would invade the privacy of this person, and I'd hope that the abutters can appreciate that. We're doing what we can to provide a trail easement, and when we all come together with the resolution of that for the Conservation Commission and the abutters, I think we'd be happy to oblige. I guess, not to beat a dead horse, but the issue of again, the use of the trails by motorized vehicles. I don't think that there's anything we can do to prohibit that, and I think that's a broader issue for the Trails Committee and for the Greenbelt Plan, the use of motorized vehicles. I don't think that anyone sitting on this board can deny that by putting a trail in, you are in a sign stating no motorized vehicles, that you're going to achieve the end by using that means. I think that it just requires policing, first of all, by the town, and number two, more importantly, by the people that live on, by, or near the trails, and those people that use the trails. And I think it's an issue that I think that deserves some attention is how do you restrict motorized vehicles? Again, we intend on all the open space to restrict it as Stonegate phases 1, 2, and 3 has from any motorized use. And if anyone has any suggestions as to how to do it, to keep it non-motorized, fine, I think we're open to suggestions. I think I've hit most of the points. Thank you.
Okay. The public hearing is technically closed. Well, do the other board members feel about reopening the public hearing?
I have not, No objection.
No objection.
I don't either. But the public hearing is now reopened, and Ms. Harkavy will reapproach.
Following my neighbor Bud Higgins' illustrious footsteps here, take a second shot. With due respect to Land Use Associates, to put a very fine point on our concern here about Lot 17 as a direct abutter to Lot 17, the lower area here where there will be septic, and we are very concerned about septic drainage into wetland in these lower areas as well, is not in our backyard. During a period of time when I lived in Cumberland, when a septic system drained into what could effectively be called a wet area, which I believe was not as wet as this. After periods of rain, and particularly in the spring, there was really an aesthetic problem when the wind blew the wrong way. And the best way I could describe it is smell, and or the most polite way. And I'm very concerned because I'm familiar with the drainage and the wetness and so forth in Lot 17. Because if you don't like the way the wind is blowing, just wait a minute. I'm awfully concerned when the snow starts to melt or we have heavy rains or the drainage in the ground is poor. For example, right now, I understand the ground is frozen roughly 18 inches down, but the ground really isn't absorbing any water. So when you get a little bit of thaw, whatever runs onto or into the ground tends to stand because there's nowhere for it to flow. And to me, Lot 17 represents a real aesthetic problem to certainly lots 47, 48, potentially lot 49, possibly the folks across the street. And if the wind is blowing in the direction of the Stamieshkin's house and the Grabowski's house and some of those others that are on the road that goes in the other direction, I forget the name of the road. I think it's Gate Ledge Road, is it? Or is, which road is that? Is that Gate Ledge Road?
Granite Ridge
Road. I would be concerned that they, too, would be in direct line of a pretty unaesthetic situation. And I'm sorry to put such a fine point on it, but that is our concern.
Thank you. Take one more.
Hello, I'm Jim Granulati again.
One
point I wanted to mention is that in the existing bylaws and covenants, at least as I interpret them, the review rights and kind of the veto power, for lack of a better term, in terms of how houses are sited and design of homes, rest with declarant. The declarant used to be Stonegate Associates, which was largely Bob Taylor. And I believe that when the lots went back to Fleet Bank, the rights of declarant also flowed back to Fleet Bank and subsequently to Recall Management. Therefore, how homes are sited on, for instance, Lot 17, which has been the lot that most people have spoken about tonight, the final decision, whether it's, it really rests with Recall Management, the applicant in front of you. The Homeowners Association has a right or a privilege to review any plans, both the site plans and the elevations and that sort of mm-hmm. things for the home, but it's purely advisory. There's absolutely no power that the association has as regards to the siting of the home. It's really up to the declarant. In this case, I believe that is Recall Management and town codes. So I just wanted to make that clear. Thank you.
Thank you. The public meeting or hearing is now formally, officially, and finally closed. Comments from the board. Mr. Emery.
Thank you. I just have several brief comments. First of all, I would like to thank the public as well for all of their concern with the letters and having come here tonight to make a public statement about the issues. Let me begin with lot number 17. I don't think there's anything ruder that could happen in the process of buying a lot or having an interest in a lot than have someone come in and put a lot behind you that wasn't there when you first looked at the opportunity to buy a lot. I feel quite strongly that that requires an amendment to the previous subdivision application, which I understand is not before us tonight. But in any event, I can't vote in favor of this plan with Lot 17 delineated the way it is. I just find it unconscionable that someone on either Lot 49, 50, or 47 would be put in that position. I say that in particular concern with the scale of the houses that are throughout Stonegate. They're very large houses, not necessarily in square footage, but volumetrically, they tend to be very tall. And regardless of the difference in elevation, I just think that for someone on our plan, the Thielen lot particularly, who would be looking out into what would have been open space, is now going to be a 2.5-story house. I just find as a way of amending this plan, it shows very little sensitivity to the previous subdivision. In terms of the plat plan in front of us, and assuming that we'd be signing this, it's my understanding there are several issues that will be remedied this, but I'll speak to other concerns. The issue of the emergency access to the Dyer Pond subdivision. I think, if anything, where we tend to be guilty of these days is very short-term thinking. Obviously, we're only around for 70 years, plus or minus, so we have to gauge that in that perspective. But this is this subdivision has two unusual characteristics. One, it is a last opportunity to think about the future of the town. There's been a lot of discussion lately about planning approaches and that this idea of dead-end streets and private neighborhoods is not very conducive in the long-term success of creating a sense of community. It works perfectly well for the short term, but for the longer-term development of the community, it may be, in a sense, a roadblock. So from that standpoint, I don't have concerns about the future opportunity of allowing connection to Shore Road. Secondly, the Planning Board and the Town Council worked very closely with the developer in terms of amending the language to allow a 2,000-foot dead-end street. And given some of the fire hazards and so forth, this may be an opportunity or some other hazard, illness or something, to allow in the future emergency vehicles to get into the subdivision from that other direction. I'll also make it clear that I have lived out of state in Massachusetts. I lived on what was called a parkway, which became a four-lane commuter road that was across the street from a bridge, from a beach, I'm sorry. And the notion of public access was as strong there as it is here, and the idea of the rights of the public to use public property is a very noble gesture, but I think it comes from a time when people had a natural respect for other people's property. So I think wherever possible, while it's very important to have a trail system throughout the community, the rights of the private property owner have to be taken into consideration. And since this is a new subdivision, I see that as an opportunity to work the subdivision delineation around that sort of good use of property, a public need, rather than to somehow arbitrarily come up with lot lines and then try to jam in those trails around them. And I know that Jack has worked very hard and he's worked with the developer in the past, and I'm assuming he will continue to work equally as hard. And please keep in mind his notion of also a long-term situation. It may only be an easement that goes nowhere in 1990, 2025, but in 2050 maybe it makes the final jewel on the necklace, so to speak. I have a couple of concerns about the plat plan in front of us, and I'll just direct this to the town planner. One is the issue of the Greystone court reconfiguration as to whether or not the property line or some other indication should be shown that that's part of, although that was a previous phase, that work is in, is now as part of this approval, if I'm correct.
That right-of-way has already been donated to the town, so even though the road is not going to swing in that, I'm assuming that you're talking about the reconfiguration where the
That's
road
correct.
Isn't going to swing in, we will still own that right-of-way, even though though we will not be putting a road there, because it's already been dedicated
okay.
to us.
But that work will be done by the developer?
Yes.
We have a lovely plan in front of us that Land Use Consultants has prepared that shows the connection between Dyer Pond and all the phases of Stonegate. It's a wonderful opportunity to see this whole area. in one piece, and I can't help but notice a wetland easement that comes across lots 23 and 24, across Stonegate Road into lots 50 and 51. And then as I look at this recording plat, I don't see any indication of that. And admittedly, this recording plat is not dealing specifically with issues of whatever phase that was, previous phase two. But it would seem to me for anyone purchasing property or looking at property that there should be some consistency that things like those easements should somehow be delineated on this plat. It seems to me very important that things that are on the other side of the property line, although they're not specifically within the subdivision itself, should carry through. And I would also make a similar comment with respect to the easement that abuts parcel A and runs between phases 3 and 2 and that lot 17 area, the proposed lot 17. There's only a note on the plan that says now formerly Fleet Bank of Maine. It would seem to me as if there is a conservation easement or a trail or something there that's dedicated to the town, that should also be listed. I was looking to see if there was any indication of a limit of clearing line, either on the roadway construction documents or as a part of the plat plan itself, and I haven't seen any. Is it assumed that the clearing limit would be to the limit of grading?
Yeah, that's the intent. On the plan and profile views, we've discussed that the limit of clearing is shown by the grading lines on the plan. And are you referring to the individual lots?
Well, no, generally I'm thinking of the road and the issue of the right-of-way and whether this right-of-way is going to be cleared right-of-way line to right-of-way line or whether it's going to be done more sensitively and it would be, you know, trees would be flagged in sight to be preserved and those sorts of appropriate things that,
yeah,
as long as we maintain sight lines and safety.
Mm-hmm. I think as you stated earlier in the last meeting, our intent is to work the best we can within the right-of-way to expose those areas of ledge. I mentioned there's one or two spots where we may be able to, again, determine in the field at the time of construction, save the ledge and bring the side areas closer to the pavement and still meet the design requirements that the town has and that we've worked together with the reviewing engineer to, in terms of several rock, riprap, drainage swales, and that sort of thing. And we can't, I think, pinpoint those spots on the plan, but the intent is to be sensitive to the road design and go out there and flag trees and save them, if at all possible, any of the larger caliper trees to get it. I think it just creates for a better atmosphere and a better designed road. And we can't, again, I can't sit here and tell you where those places are going to be. I think we've tried to indicate them best with the grading lines on the plan. That is our intent.
While you're up, I guess I have another. Could you help me to understand, in the cul-de-sac itself, is the center going to be paved or is that going to be left in its existing condition?
The center, the cul-de-sac itself is an area of fill, so there won't be any trees and whatnot growing there. What we intend on doing is having a paved circle with an island. I think it's a 20-foot radius. Is that diameter? Mm-hmm. 20, I think it's a 20-foot radius. Correct me if I'm wrong. It could be diameter. Island in the center, which would be grassed. And we've discussed this with I personally would like to see some landscaping in the center of the island. However, after discussing the geometry of that with the fire department with their ladder truck, we've determined that it's best to leave that without any large boulders or landscaping, that sort of thing, so that in emergency the truck can maneuver around the cul-de-sac and make several turns, and they can ride. These are Cape Cod curbs, so they're mountable curbs. Mm-hmm. And that nothing of any importance put in the middle of the cul-de-sac, but it will be grass as a minimum.
There was an issue raised regarding drainage and the brook that would be bisected by the if a future construction of Dyer Pond Road. Presumably that would have to be some sort of either a culverted or bridged road expansion, and that issue would be addressed through the appropriate regulatory agencies, the DEP and so forth. I personally don't see that as a real issue. I don't anticipate that Cranbrook would be dammed up because of that future expansion.
Can I just add, on that same subject, I think I failed to mention that this crossing here, we looked at it in the field, and we're, what our intention is, and I've spoken to DEP about this, is to simply put several, in the wintertime, it's a trail passage, it's skiable, it's walkable, given the ice, whatnot, but to put several stones just in the brook, if we can get away with that, with the permit by rule standards of the DEP, and just walk across the brook that way. And DEP was a little fuzzy when I spoke to them about whether that qualifies for permit by rule, so it's we'll resolve that one way or the other to get across that.
Okay, now you mentioned in your presentation this issue of the shaded areas on the recording plat, which are the building envelope, and they're quite variable. And there are some areas where there is no setback given, for instance, on lots 11 and 10. I don't see any, or even perhaps 12, I don't see a setback distance. Is that 100 feet at that point, or is it, I just think it would be appropriate to give that distance in each case.
The answer to your question, yes, we can add some distances, dimensions on there, and yes, that is 100 feet on those lots.
Now, really send a shiver down your spine. I'll address this issue to the planner. What do those lines mean in the field? And I think, Rick, you could probably add some light to this conversation, and that's how I intend it. For a homeowner who obviously would have this plat or this recording deed, and there would be a 100-foot setback, has the town typically required that line somehow be arbitrarily defined on the face of the earth through meets and bounds, or is it simply left up to each property owner and the code enforcement officer to determine where that line is in the field?
The actual boundary of the lots is marked, but the footprint or the building envelope is determined by the code enforcement officer and the landowner in the field. Usually with the code enforcement officer, if there's a question, they may ask the landowner to help with some surveying and get something drawn to scale and shown on the site. But with previous subdivisions where there have been building envelopes, usually that's what has been worked out. Is the code enforcement hasn't told me of any instance where he's had real difficulty determining where a building envelope has been located.
Okay, if that's indeed the case, and I would have no reason to believe otherwise, it would seem to me just appropriate to put a dimension on the plan for each one of those setback conditions. I guess that's generally all, most of my comments. Is there anything in your proposal that would contribute monies toward the improvement of the intersection at Mitchell Road? I heard the Homeowners Association say that they intended to upgrade that, and they always felt that perhaps with a continuing developer coming through the process that may have been part of the next phase of development. If I'm putting words into the Stonegate Associates' mouth, please say so, but is there any intention of providing any additional improvements, or have you had any discussions with them about that?
I've had no discussions at this point. In fact, the first that I heard of it was tonight, and all I can say is that as part of the I assume that these monies are part of the association dues, and as this becomes part of the overall association, that the respective dues from the homeowners there would go towards those. If there's a different plan, I think we're at a point now to where we'll be sitting down with the homeowners association in the very near future to discuss some of these issues, but I can't say. I assume that's the mechanism as to how it will work.
I only put this in light of, I don't know if, I can't say that Bob Taylor said it, it may have been implied that once Phase 4 came along, there'd be additional monies contributed to the improvements of that intersection, and that was the only holdup. I would see that as sort of a front-end contribution versus something that the homeowners would be contributing as they come on board, so to speak. And I would like to see that as something worked out between the developer and the homeowners association to the satisfaction of each.
We'd be happy to sit down and talk it over with them.
Thank you.
We have another board member who'd like to have some questions or comments.
Certainly.
Mr. Parkhurst.
Following along with Tom's comment, and just a quick question, is there the room in the second entranceway to improve it the same way the first entranceway was improved? It doesn't appear so from the plan.
I'm sorry, I don't understand the question.
Well, The second entranceway, which is unimproved at this point, doesn't appear from the plan that I have in front of me that has enough room to be improved like the first entranceway. Not that plan, but the overall plan of the whole neighborhood.
You're speaking of the entranceway to Mitchell?
Yes.
Or?
Yes.
Again, I can't speak, maybe the association could speak. I'm not sure what the improvements are that are being talked about there. Like I said, I think we'd be glad to sit down with the association and talk about improvements, whether they're landscaping or improving the island. I don't know at this point, and I can't speak.
Couple other comments, and Tom has covered most of the things I wanted to cover, but I too have to voice my very strong concern for lot 17. I know I would probably put my lot up for sale if I was owned lot 48 or 47, because I would not want that in my backyard. I feel very strongly also about doing something to limit the access from Dyer Pond to Stonegate. It concerns me that it would become a throughway. And the last question or comment, and is a question, for Maureen, do you know who has right title and interest in the Allen Road Paper Street?
Right now, we don't know who has right title and interest in that road. We're assuming that the town has some public right in that road. And in speaking with the Conservation Commission chair, he's put it on his list of goals for this year to make that determination. Right now, there's some assumption that we have some rights in that road and that we would like to preserve them for pedestrian access. And with the deadline coming up with state legislation in 1997, the town would have to act before that time to assert our rights in that road, otherwise they'd be extinguished.
That's all for me.
Thank you, Steve. Judy Lardner.
First, I'd like to start off, I think, to comment on a major problem we've had. It's more an ordinance problem than anything else, and it's very evident as we look at this project. This project has been a pending application for 2 years now. It was certified complete in February of 1990, and I think a lot of the concerns of the public, and certainly my own, might not be here if that ordinance or that the lack of an ordinance that would control something like this would be in place. On one hand, we have an applicant, actually a new applicant. There's no provisions for a change of applicant to trigger any sort of new review or new standards, but an applicant is able to take the advantages, I believe, of earlier wetlands requirements or lack thereof, and somehow they'll work with newer requirements such as the dead-end roadway standard, which I think favor the applicant. And I also think it's a better development using a dead-end road as opposed to the loop because the wetlands aren't as affected as much. But I think there is a lot of problems such as the issue of Lot 17. Well, let me say is I don't like that either, but I also can say looking back in my records, that lot has been on the plan since December of 89, and it's hard to know where you feel when property owners have purchased their properties since then, and it amazes me that I guess it was Lot 48 was purchased a year ago, and yet there was confusion that these plans were on the record. That really disturbs me. It disturbs me that in some ways I feel my hands are tied because of previous approvals, and it's not the applicant's fault either. So I wanted to start that. I hope the public understands that in a lot of ways the board is very concerned that a project like this can hang on, and you can't touch a lot of things like the wetlands because that's what the ordinance says. We have to consider them under the more lenient standards. My specific questions or comments, though, is Maureen, could you indicate how this public hearing was advertised and who was notified?
The public hearing was advertised. It was published notice was placed in the Press Herald and was published a week ago from this date. In accordance with town ordinance, notices were also mailed to all abutters a week ago this date as well. Our addresses we get off of the assessor's charts, those, I believe, are updated every April. So at this point, if someone has purchased a lot within the last year, we probably did not mail them a notice. The one other notice we do have is that I believe there was an article in the Cape Courier that noticed, that referenced there would be a public hearing on this item tonight. So, and those are mailed to all residents in town.
Were the abutters immediate abutters, or the abutters within, or the neighbors within 1,000 feet of the property?
The ordinance requires the closest 25 abutters, or all of those people within 500 feet. In addition, I did speak with some of the people who lived in Stonegate, and one of the residents gave me the most current address of the president of the association. So even if he had not been an abutter, he would have received a notice, hopefully spreading that to the neighbors. I would like to take one moment to correct one other, I guess, piece of misinformation that's been going around about having to get letters into the town 10 days in advance of a hearing. I did speak to some residents who expressed concern that this meeting was going to be held during school vacation week and that some people would not be able to attend, and I encouraged them to write letters instead. I believe what I specifically told people was that if you got your letter to me within a week of the meeting, that I would be able to make sure it was delivered to planning board members and they would have time to read it prior to the meeting. However, if you do not get it to me a week before the meeting, I still would be able to photocopy it and pass it out to members at the meeting this evening. And there are some letters that you have received tonight that come in after the package has gone out to the planning board. So, you know, at any time up to the beginning of the meeting, letters can be distributed to the planning board.
Okay. Then another thing perhaps you could explain for my benefit and perhaps the public is the town's policy or requirements on sewage versus septic systems on lots and what the developer has to do.
It's often the case that most developers will come in and would like to hook up into the sewer system. However, the existing sewer ordinance is very restrictive. It was designed to be neutral to growth. That is that it was designed only to serve existing demand at that time. If you do not have frontage on a street that had sewer put in, and if you don't have sufficient frontage, you're not allowed to hook up to sewer whether or not you want to. All of these lots have septic systems on them, which have been reviewed by the code enforcement officer and which comply with our septic system requirements. If this developer had come forward and requested to be put on sewer, he would not be able to get the sewer permits to hook up to the system.
Thank you. I guess I would like to comment then on the pedestrian easements. I'm very sensitive to the Gatchell's concerns about having a dead-end easement, and I've heard Jack Roberts indicate that certainly those easements would not be signed unless we do have access somehow, whether it's a lot two, I'm not sure. But I guess I don't know if this is for you or an attorney. If the easements exist and they're defined on the ground, whether they're signed or not, I assume a public person could use them. I know I would. If I thought I had a legal right, I would walk on them. And I wouldn't want the Getchells to assume that if it's not signed, then no one will be going down there.
No, if we do have a public easement, then someone would be able to use them. However, in some cases, we're trying to preserve existing trails as much as possible, but in the course of development, you're typically losing some of those trails, and so we try to establish new connections. In the Gatchell's case, there's nothing in their area right now that suggests a trail as far as I could see. There would have to be a trail cut. If it was not marked and was not maintained, someone would have to actually figure out where it was and then work their way through the woods. Just to add to what the Conservation Commission chair had discussed, there was some discussion about getting the pedestrian easement on the lower part of Lot 3, which abuts mm-hmm. the Gatchell's property. The intent there was to provide some kind of access for the Cranbrook neighborhood to this vast amount of open space, which has become available to the town. In walking out there the other day, it was apparent that above Lot 3, there is an existing trail which some people are using right now. So what we had discussed informally, although it's not a formal recommendation of the Conservation Commission, is that any request for an easement on the lower part of Lot 3 be that we eliminate that request. And since we will own the land above Lot 3, that we could pursue that particular trail at some future date once we started making contact with the Cranbrook neighbors at that particular location. But in going out there, we're just trying to find ways to keep the trails that it's clear people are currently using.
Okay, thank you. With respect to the right-of-way, I am one of those people who believe it's good planning to preserve right-of-ways. I'm certainly not in favor of a road, but I know we have a lot of problems in town elsewhere, such as Shore Acres and Broad Cove, where there's a real problem with it's desirable to have other accesses, and that's a secondary access issue. It's not the same issue here, but I think it's extremely important that when we have the possibility to preserve right-of-ways, we don't know at what point in the future it might be desirable to have a roadway or even a more intensive pedestrian usage in there. I certainly would hope that the board would favor preserving a right-of-way, but not in any way indicating to the town that we are condoning building a road at this point. You have a lot of leeway if we preserve those things now. Sorry, my comments are disjointed this evening. I guess my final comment would be going back to Lot 17, even though it's been on the plans and on the books for over 2 years. I would certainly hope you would talk to the applicant and see if there's any way that they could reconsider, because I do think it does not fit in. I understand the topography there and how a house might be a little more hidden, but I don't think it's doing any credit to the new developer to try to keep that in there. Thank you. Mr. Eichenberg.
Thank you. In the interest of time, I'll make it very brief. I'd like to thank everybody for their input and for the extensive correspondence that we got and for showing up here at this hour. My four basic concerns are the septic systems, which I realize that the developer is in a bind because of the nature of the sewer hookup problem here. And I do also realize that test pits have been bored, and that the code enforcement office and the plumbing inspector have approved the septic system. So if there's a problem with the design of the septic system ordinance or the regulations of the plumbing code, then maybe we should take a look at that. But I assume that if the code enforcement officer approves the septic system, that the septic system won't fail and will not leach into the wetlands and cause an odor problem. If there is a problem, engineering problem with that, then we should know about that. We should address that in the regulations that we have. I congratulate the efforts of the developer to hook up this development with the greenbelt system. I think it's very important that we preserve the greenbelt system in the town. This would be our legacy for the next generation. Once the land is developed, it's developed forever, and we lose these systems unless we can preserve them, even if there aren't any connections at the moment that we actually get them. It's good to plan ahead, and if we don't sign them and keep them at least on paper, then eventually maybe we can connect them all up, and it'll be a tremendous benefit to the town in the long run. I'm concerned about the public notice. Not everyone apparently was notified of the hearing. It appears as if we've done all that we could to notify everyone. If there is a new owner to any of the abutting lots, then maybe we can try to think of a way of informing everyone and making sure that everyone gets notice of these hearings and gets correspondence. Even if they are recent owners, maybe we can look into that at some workshop sessions. Find out some way that we can improve the notice situation. But short of sending letters to all the abutters, that we have information regarding and advertising in the newspaper, I don't think there's any other way that we can do it. So I'm fairly satisfied that we've done all right, but I think that there might be procedures we could look into and improve our notice. And finally, I am concerned with Lot 17. I do notice that through the lot configuration, it does abut on Stonegate Road. And did I hear someone say that there might be a possibility of hooking into the sewer system if a property does abut a major road? Did I hear you say that, Maureen?
Yes, I did, but I'm assuming right now that there's a good reason why they can't hook up Lot 17 to the sewer. Lot 1, which is part of this phase, is hooking up to the sewer because it does have frontage on Greystone Court, and I would have to look into further to see if there's a reason why Lot 17 can't hook up into the sewer.
Part of that, Maureen, I think part of that may be the frontage requirements that are necessary for a single hookup. I'm not sure with the ordinance, but that may be it. You need 100 feet for a single hookup.
Yeah, that would be my guess, but I would want to check into it.
I would like to check on that because I think that would at least address some concerns. If that Lot 17 were on sewer, I think that would at least address some of the concerns, not all of them. But that might help you out. I was concerned with Lot 2 and access to Lot 3, which some people expressed at the public hearing. However, now that we've discussed the green, primarily for Greenbelt situation, I didn't want to see a Greenbelt which would impinge on existing property owners that were adjoining. However, now that we've learned from the Conservation Commission that link is not absolutely necessary and that it won't be marked, I think that my concerns with Lot 3 and Lot 2 have been ameliorated to some extent. So I'll end it there.
Have any further comment from the board? I have.
Should have known.
Back in
Should
the hot
known.
Seat. Most of the my comments have been addressed by other members, but I want you to know what at least is on my mind. I'm not sure whether I was zoning out for the 3 seconds when you gave the answer of what was recall going to do with this. Would you please tell me one more time?
With the project.
I just went to sleep for about 3 seconds. I didn't hear your answer.
My understanding is recall will, since they're not developers and the interest of recall is to manage properties for the FDIC, this property will be sold or turned over to a developer, someone who will develop the property.
As a whole?
As a whole. Not in a piece by piece, but as a whole, as a package. With the permits, okay. State approvals, and local approvals once
right.
they reach that level.
With that, I would comment for everyone here that not only when you have a new developer will they have to have transfer of developer rights, proving financial capability, and a few other things by the DEP, they will also have to come before the planning board and the town to get our blessing as a new developer. So I was very concerned that we would have someone not as good perhaps as we might want to see come in here. So there will have to be someone who can build this, develop it with the insight and vision that the whole development has seen along here. Number two was that there isn't any way that I, as a board member, would see Stonegate 4 under anything less stringent than Stonegate 1, 2, and 3C. That means the standards, the declarations, the style, as much as I can possibly do, will be involved with that, and I think we have the full support of the board. Number three, I do not like Lot 17. I didn't like it, but I kept thinking, well, maybe it'll grow on me. It hasn't. And I think you probably have the consensus from the board that there would not be a favorable vote. At least I wouldn't vote for it if it had Lot 17. It just doesn't make sense. I think you, as Tom Emery said, I mean, the homes are big. They're voluminous. They're beautiful, multi-gabled. Lovely homes, and they just can't squeeze it in there without it looking like it wouldn't work. I don't care for that. I'm somewhat confused now on the road names. I thought that Greystone Road was going to become Rock Crest Road.
Greystone Road will become Rock Crest Road, correct?
Okay, the whole line. And then Greystone Court will remain Greystone Court.
Well, that's the tricky part.
Yeah,
this actually is Greystone Road at this point. It gets, the plot thickens. Greystone Road was here, it was going to be transferred to here, and this is going to become the subliminal, the Greystone Court as a minor, you know, a minor street. What we're saying, just to keep the recording plats and keep the legal descriptions on the existing plan as simple as possible, leave this as Greystone Road as it is now. This actually was the change to Court. Make this Rock Crest Drive and, of course, Quartz Knob. Leave that as it is.
Rock Crest Drive will go from Stonegate Road to the cul-de-sac.
Road to the cul-de-sac. I guess there's a logistical problem here, or I guess the question is to where these roads start. The pavement surface, if you look at the road in terms of driving it, this would be one road. It would make sense to me to keep this as a single road, Rock Crest Drive from Stonegate.
That's what makes sense to me.
And then to where this tees off, this 350 feet or whatever would be Greystone Road as it is now. The difference is that at this point now, because this is a single road, this is all Greystone Road from Stonegate. It's a technical issue that in terms of stationing of the roadway and right-of-ways, this is an existing right-of-way and we're cutting into it here. So the question is, where do you splice and merge the two? It's sticky.
It's sticky.
Yeah.
It makes a lot more sense for it to be Rock Crest Drive from Stonegate Road.
All the way through.
That's
our intent.
Than to have it the other way.
I think that's our intent. It'll just make sense from driving the road if the town will accept the streets that way, in that fashion. That's the way
we'd like to propose them. No one will ever find anything if you do it that way. I think it should be like that. Okay. I have that. Now, I understand you're clear-cutting the cul-de-sac at the end.
Yes, the cul-de-sac in itself, this half of it, I guess it would be the northern half of this, northeastern half, is actually in a fill situation. This is about a grade on this side, or if it's slightly into cut. This is in fill, so you're going to be clearing it anyway. And as I discussed with public safety, they would like to have the paved area, the island, and there's still 10 feet between the edge of the cul-de-sac surface and the right-of-way. If we can maintain that and vegetate it as much as possible, it allows him more room to get his vehicle around if he has to make several moves to get on the cul-de-sac.
Are there any substantial trees in the cul-de-sac?
Not to my knowledge. We haven't actually located them. I've walked this site. Nothing more than there are on the rest of the site. I can't say there isn't a 12-inch diameter oak in the middle of it. We haven't actually flagged the trees, but I've walked that, and no more significant than anywhere else on the site that I know of.
I'm trying to remember from our last site walk, which was about a year ago, it seems, or close to it. Mosquito.